Okay, I see this as a big story. I can probably get significant space. What do you think the story is that I should tell? You have to listen as a reporter to really find out. Look at Reuters on the iPad. Look at us on the iPad. Look at the BBC on the iPad. Look at Le Monde on the iPad. We all kind of look alike, right? We've all got video, we've all got audio, we've all got the big text, the little text, the picture that might move or not. And so this whole idea, well, I'm in the radio business, I'm in the television business, I'm in the newspaper business, I think that's really going away. We're all in the content business. You know, you make it as good as you can, as fast as you can, you file on many platforms, you make video, you do the website, you write the story, you Twitter out what you've done, you do a blog post about what you've done, then you collapse, sleep for a while, and then you get up again and do it the next day. Being a journalist, I never feel bad talking to journalism students because it's a grand, grand caper. You know, you get to leave, go talk to strangers, ask them anything, come back, type up their stories, edit the tape. No, that's not going to retire your loans as quickly as it should, and it's not going to turn you into a person who's worried about what kind of car they should buy, but that's kind of as it should be. I mean, it beats working. The other day, I was a little late for class, and I came running down toward the class, and somebody said, oh, look, the professor's here, and like everybody else, I turned and looked. The thing that has been stunning to me is the level of seriousness that my students are bringing to the work at hand. I mean, people, there's a lot to worry about in the world, but I think worrying about this next generation is a waste of time. I think they got it going on.
I feel like when losing David, I lost my biggest advocate, and I think a lot of other young journalists felt that way too.
And I guess in some ways, David was our journalism parent, and he wasn't just for us. I mean, there are legions of David Carr disciples out there.
He had little like phrases that he would use, like ABP, always be pimping. It means send those stories out. If you write something that's good, send it to people who matter, you know, make sure that your stories get out there and don't be ashamed.
He's inherently impatient about copy, and he knows when people are shooting the bull with their writing, and he calls them out on it.
Yeah, I mean, the thing is, like, when he yelled at us, he was right. And it's sort of hard to fault someone for being right.
He believe that we were in a golden age of journalism, which is something that you really don't hear often right now. You hear that journalism is dying or that newspapers are dying. David really genuinely felt like that was garbage. He believed in the quality of young journalists. He believed in the internet. He believed in the changing face of journalism. And that was really refreshing and really helpful for us.
I think I agree with him that this is a time when anyone can go out there and do anything.
He was such a positive person, I think, about himself and about other young journalists, because he's sort of been to hell and back in his own life.
I think I came away from the class realizing that in order to be a good journalist, you also have to be a good person, which sounds totally obvious, but I think that was the big lesson that I took away from being in his class.
You know, I'm kind of a pirate, kind of a thug. I mean, I've done a bunch of terrible things, and yet I'm able to, for the most part, be a decent person. How is that? Do I have some inner strength of character? I think not. I think something else is working on me.
I'm Charlie Kravitz, general manager of WBUR. I didn't know David Carr very well, or for very long, but one didn't need a long relationship to fall for him. Indeed, to fall under David's spell was a shared experience that so many of us had. I met David when I was part of the committee to recruit and choose the first LAC professor at Boston University. Along with Chris Daly, Marshall Van Alstyne, Bill McKean, and Ann Donahue, I met David twice over two good meals. In truth, I didn't need the second meal to know that David was the one. the right choice, the perfect combination of brilliant practitioner and devoted teacher. And all of David's students in the short time he was here at Boston University can, and of course some of them just did, attest to the wisdom of the choice. I remember having a classic David Carr experience when he called me up a few months ago to get my thoughts on the breakout podcast Serial. I went on for a bit about the state of public radio, and then there was a pause. David said, "Okay, Charlie, don't waste my time. Tell me something interesting, something meaningful." And that was it. The real David Carr. The authentic journalist, never settling for the trite or predictable, always searching for the inflection point, the moment of change, the unacknowledged trend, the narrative arc. I was supposed to meet David for dinner 2 weeks ago to talk about a project with WBUR. It never happened. There are too many what-ifs that we are all dealing with in the death of this extraordinary person and journalist. Tonight, we were scheduled to do the second of our series with David called Fast Forward. The first was with Jill Abramson in this very room. Instead, we are gathered here tonight to remember David Carr and to discuss his legacy. So please welcome the moderator of tonight's conversation, the host of Radio Open Source on WBUR, Chris Lydon.
Thank you, Charlie. I am Chris Lydon, and I'm hugely honored to be part of remembering David Carr. We had another Blue Monday morning today without his column in the New York Times, which had become addictive and part of all our conversations. But there's so many reasons to remember this man. The voice alone, but he played an absolutely one-of-a-kind role in an historic transition in media, the media industry, but the way this country talks to itself. Not the least of the things I admired about David was his timing. I mean, he picked not the time to leave, but a perfect time to be present, eyes open, in this not exactly contest, but certainly a transition between this cresting power of digital media, the technological utopia still rising, and the ebbing but still contentious power of institutional media, legacy media. The point about David was not just that he was a superb practitioner, knew all the tricks of both trades, and knew them intimately, they were at the tips of his fingers. The real point, I think, is that he was madly in love with both forces alive in this world he was reporting on. And I mean, I think love was a lot of it. You can hear it in his voice, you can hear it in the voice of his students. To millions and millions of new commentators on our world out there, you know, the famous bloggers in their pajamas at the typewriter, he was incredibly generous but eager to confer legitimacy, and to all the endangered souls at the New York Times. And they really are endangered, and they're in trouble, and he knew it. But he was dying to give them a promise of a long lease on life, too. So he was not just treasured and admired, but he was celebrated, and he was loved in return by this whole world. We were talking about this earlier, and I was thinking, before we're done tonight, I think we should consider the question of the sainthood of David Carr. He would be in Rome, he would be up for canonization already, and probably have a very good case. Tonight, I do want to say one other thing. He was an enormous ornament in the time he had to Boston University and to the School of Journalism and the practice of journalism here. I think it's sad that we meet tonight during the BU spring break. A lot of his students, a lot of his colleagues are away for this time, but it's a distinguished and wonderful audience that's here, and we're going to try to get to the soul of it. Three others on the panel tonight. different relationships with David. Jill Abramson was his boss at the New York Times. Ta-Nehisi Coates was his protege and also his successor in the teaching of journalism at Boston University. Seth Mnookin was his friend, his sometimes originally and again his colleague out on a story. So it's a great pleasure for me to ask those three to join us on the stage and have at the questions, the answers, the power of David Carr.
Do what I'm told.
We begin. Don't sit down, Ta-Nehisi. Well, yeah, you can sit down. Forgive me. We're going to begin with Ta-Nehisi Coates, an extraordinary journalist in his own right, who has written movingly about David and ascribes a great deal of his own thinking and practice and success and pleasure in journalism to the late David. Ta-Nehisi Coates.
Well, there are not enough people here today. Not for what David was. Although I'm happy all you guys are here. There should always be more, even during spring break, for David. Boy, where do I begin? I like to tell people that David effectively saved my life on at least three or four different occasions. You guys are gonna hear a lot about, you know, how great, and you probably already know, a journalist David was, which I think anybody can talk to, how great a human being he was. But I think what David had, and I think what a lot of young people have, you know, testified to in the many, many remembrances to David that we've seen, he had an ability to look at people at a point in their lives where they may not, you know, have looked like they had the most potential to do anything in the world. I have been lucky enough to experience a small bit of prominence over the past few years, and there are people, you know, who approach you all the time, who you've seen in former lives, you know, who may not have believed in the same way. David believed in me when I had nothing. David believed in me when I had turned, as I've said before, f-ing up into an art, when I had mastered it. It was what I did. I met David when I was 20 years old. Nothing was going right. I was a student at Howard University. I was out of school at the time. I had, you know, taken a semester off because I had finally gotten the notion at school, the correct notion, by the way, that school was not the place for me. I had always been, you know, pretty much a screw up in school. My parents loved me religiously and courageously, but could not figure out what was going on in my head. I had gotten suspended in ninth grade for assaulting a teacher, which sounds much worse than it actually was. I mean, it's bad, but it wasn't as bad as that sounds. In 10th grade, I got suspended effectively for the same thing. Different teacher. Okay. Different teacher, same school. Same school. I got kicked out of school in 10th grade. My parents came back up to school, argued me back into that school. And then I got kicked out again in 11th grade. And this was like who I was, you know, all the way up until the time, you know, I was 20 years old, and I heard from a friend that there was an internship at the Washington City Paper where David was the editor. And I sent him some really, really mediocre articles from the student newspaper at Howard University and some awful black nationalist poetry. And he looked at that and said, "You're the one." You're the one, you know? And I had, I had never really succeeded at anything, but I came that summer for 3 months. It was a unique internship in the sense that they rarely, rarely required you to do work for other journalists. You were there to write, man. You were there, and they gave you a base salary, and then they paid you, you know, some, you know, a ridiculously impoverished wage to freelance. But it was money. It was money. And the notion that people could be paid to write, I knew that that was true theoretically. But that it could actually happen, that you could actually get a check, and all your job was to go out there and answer, you know, the questions in your mind, was amazing to me, and it was a revelation to me. And so, I started at the City Paper as a journalist, and I tell you, I never looked back.
Can I interrupt you one sec?
Sure.
Be as tough-minded as you can, as David Carr as you can. What was it? And no modesty or false modesty. What was it he saw in your pieces?
I'm not being falsely modest at all.
He saw something.
No, I'm dead serious. I'm dead serious. David Carr was not the first person to see me write. And he probably wasn't the first person to say, you have some talent in this. But the idea that I should commit to you and pay you, you know what I mean? Mm. David, for instance, I had been working there for like 2 months. And my mother called one day. And, you know, David comes by, and I'm on the phone. I guess he overheard me, and he says, that's your mother. You know how David talked, right? And I said, yeah, give me the phone. So I give him the phone. And he gets on the phone, and he says, I just want you to know that your son is here working his ass off. No one had ever told my mother that I worked my ass off at anything. Now, plenty of people said I was intelligent, you know, a lot of potential, da-da-da, but not, you know, look, this kid is actually, you know, he actually cares about something. And so, like, David would say things like that to people, right? And when he did, it was like, oh, so I guess I better go work my ass off then. You know what I mean? He had this way of praising you that put pressure on you. You know what I mean? Like, it made you want to live up to his praise.
But I'm also thinking, you're a very, very significant voice now in American in the American conversation with itself, certainly since the extraordinary article in The Atlantic on the case for reparations, the depth of white supremacy in our institutions and in our thinking, how much of that did he see in you? No, I don't mean the theory and the argument, but the path-breaking voice.
He thought I could write. He thought I could write and that I really needed to learn how to report. That's what he thought.
Okay. He
felt like, and at that time he had this theory. He always felt like he could hire writers and turn them into reporters. That was his basic, you know, MO in terms of hiring young people. He thought he hired people he thought had writing talent and then tried to, you know, bust them. Because he thought reporting was just, you know, a matter of, he thought it was much more about the work and that he could make people work, you know, but he couldn't teach like pure right, and he did. I mean, I would come in there with all these grand theories of the world, and he would say, okay, go prove it. Reporting is the proof. Go prove it. And to be, you know, 20, 21 years old, to have somebody, like, in your life like that, you know what I mean, to have somebody hand you a craft like that, and me, you know, just a, you know, young black boy from West Baltimore, I mean, it just, it was life-altering. It was completely, complete, and it continued to be life-altering. We live in an era in which, and I guess maybe this is always true of all businesses, but journalism, a lot of journalists are not particularly kind to young people, you know, and they blame young people for things, and they, you know, young people are people without power. They make young people take the burden for things that they should take the burden for. And David would not only not do that, but he would, like, because he was a reporter and because he reported on media, he would know what was going on at your job that somebody was about to do to you. And he would tell you, you know, as he did for me, you know, a few times. He was just a tremendous, tremendous advocate.
You're his successor at BU now. Mm-hmm. How do you want to aspire to or plan to use what David Carr gave you to other people?
I just try to get to class every day on time and, you know, give my energy. I really do. I have to come up from New York, you know, and I'm just trying to not be late. You know, Marshawn Lynch said, I'm just trying not to get fined, you know. That's pretty much it. And that's not to say, you know, I come up there and I try to be a bad teacher, but you're not going to be David, see? You're not going to be David. And there are several moments during the class where I tell the students where I'm trying to explain something. And as I'm explaining it, I say, this is what we lost, because I can't tell you what David would tell you. I know that he would have something wise, you know, and intelligent to say. Me and Seth were talking behind stage before we came up, and Seth was saying, every day there's this moment where it's like, I'll just call David, you know, not really being aware that David isn't, I mean, being aware, but not, you know, fully accepting, you know, that David isn't here. And I don't know if this is good or bad, but there have been several moments already in only the first two classes where we've had where I've said, this is what you guys lost. You know, you lost, as far as I'm concerned, at least the greatest teacher of journalism that I ever came in contact with. Mm. And there's not too much that's going to replace that.
Mm. Seth, take it from here. You were saying that you you chose a Republican convention, of all places, to meet this character.
I don't know if anyone chooses anything with David, But yeah, in the 2000 Republican convention, he had just been hired for a now defunct website called inside.com to cover national media. And I had just been hired at a now defunct magazine called Brill's Content to cover national media. And neither of us knew what we were doing, especially. I think I knew what I was doing less than he did. Another reporter that he brought along is a writer named Jake Tapper, who's now at CNN. And I knew Jake also from some stuff I had done at Salon at the time. And so we were both like kind of pulling on Jake's suit and saying, who's that? What does that mean? What's going on over there? And Jake eventually turned to us and said, you guys are both ex-junkies. Neither of you know what you're doing. Stop bothering me and go off together. And that was the first time that David invited me to Girl Island. And I'm still not entirely sure where or what that is.
Just Us Girls,
to Girl Island. It's almost hard for me to remember a time before that when David wasn't a part of my life, because he was so such a crucial part of my life in almost everything that happened from that point on. Certainly every decision I made about work, I would ask him about, but also when I was thinking of proposing to my now wife, my now wife and I were thinking about having kids, he always thought it was somewhat amusing that I was going to him for advice. It wasn't, I guess, that I felt like he always knew the answer, but he was the only person that I knew in my life who was always going to be honest. I've never met anyone else like that, that just wouldn't feed me a lie no matter what. And he wouldn't feed me a lie. I lie to people all the time because it's easier, because it gets me out of a conversation, because I don't want to call someone out on something. And it was like David was unable to do that. He was constitutionally incapable of doing that. And and we also, he played a big role in my recovery.
I was going to say, you weren't joking about two ex-junkies. How did that figure in your conversations, in your estimate of each other?
I think if that... So we ended up briefly sharing an office. Brill's and Inside, right before they both dove off a cliff, merged in a really poor effort to survive. So we briefly shared an office. And he told me later that if I hadn't known you beforehand, I would have hated you with every fiber of my being. Because David was an infamously loud everything, but just abused. I have no idea how any computer that he ever used survived a day. Loud on the phone, and I'm not quiet, but I was also single, and so some of my conversations were trying to get dates, and there was nothing that infuriated David more than someone not working. And so he eventually got another job at New York, and he said at one point, the only reason I did that was so we could be friends, we could remain friends. I think that was one time in which he was actually not being honest. I hope that was one time he was not being honest with me. But I think save for our shared past, he might have thought that I was what I appeared to be, which was, you know, a 28-year-old. Who was convinced that he had the answers. He had more sobriety than I did when we met, and he relapsed during the period that we knew each other.
He relapsed?
Yeah. He wrote about it in his book. I've been sober for 17 years. Nothing shook me more than that.
How so?
Just because he was, he was someone who had been through similar things what I had been through, and was that did not limit his life in any way. It didn't limit his job. It didn't limit his ability to have a good time. As everyone who knows him know, Jill and I were just talking about how at South by Southwest, he would take very strategic, what he called disco naps, so he could make sure that he could go to all of the parties. It just seemed like this almost mythic figure had kind of taken this fall. I think it was important in our relationship because for the first time I got to be the one to say to him, you know, you're full of shit. Like, he was trying to convince me why it was okay that he got pulled over for a DUI or that he was back drinking again. And I was like, David, you know, if you want to tell yourself that, that's fine. But if you're going to talk to me about this, don't try and feed me this.
What did he say?
He stopped talking. He said, maybe you're right. And then he said, are you going to that meeting? And then we went to a meeting. But he eventually, he wouldn't ask me my thoughts on what was going on because he knew what they were. And I told him, if and when you want to, you know, try this again, I'll be here. And he did. And it wasn't easy. I think it was really humbling for him to need to kind of start something at the bottom like that. Mm. Dave and I both like cried at movies and car commercials and anything. But David, David didn't cry in public. He was much better about not crying in public, which is something that I'm gonna try and do, which is gonna be tough. But there's one story that I think epitomizes one aspect of why David's so special. So David and I and another friend of ours named Brett Anderson and my little brother went on a fishing trip in Louisiana a couple of years ago, probably 10 years ago now. And he had never met my brother. But David said, no, bring him. I had plans with him. He said, no, bring him along. And there are two stories. One was, so David was writing a piece and he was interviewing this boat captain who was like just, you know, spinning these outrageous tales in this like thick Cajun drawl. And David was like every 5 minutes like writing down a word or two. And at one point my brother says, David, are you getting this? This is gold. And David put down his pen and stopped and looked over at my brother and said, don't ever tell me how to do my job. my brother was like, all right. my brother is, as David and I would say, is a civilian. He's not a journalist. He actually, he runs a charter school in Coney Island. Every year he has a writing contest for the students, and he asked David to be a judge one year. Now, David lived in New Jersey, worked in Midtown. Coney Island is at least an hour subway ride. I'm my brother's brother. I lived in Brooklyn, and I don't know if I would have gone down there to do it. But from that year on, every single year, David would go down, you know, it probably took 6 hours at the end of the day, and judge this writing contest for eighth graders at a charter school in Coney Island. No one there had any idea who he was. I'm sure that he was on deadline for a lot of those nights. And that is both so astounding and completely not surprising. He had the fiercest tribal loyalty of anyone who I've ever known, and I think you saw that also in his attitude towards the Times. There's a documentary that was supposed to be about the Times that ended up about David called Page One. Is that right? Page One. Yep. And there's this one scene where that is probably the most famous scene in the movie, where he's interviewing some.
He's interviewing Shane Smith
from Vice. Yeah, and Shane is kind of slagging the Times, and he had just they had just been talking about this a travel video that Vice had done in Liberia. Is that right? Where. I think it was Liberia, where there was like human excrement on the beach, and so David's interviewing this person. This isn't a conversation. He stops, and it was sort of similar to the "Don't ever tell me how to do my job" moment. And he said, "You know, just because you go and you got some poop on a beach and are doing all this, you think you know what you're doing. That's not like don't ever talk crap about the New York Times. Do not disrespect what our war correspondents do." What the men and women who go out and put themselves in harm's way do every day. And that was like this, I think that's been held up as this rallying cry. And David was actually sort of embarrassed by that. I mean, his daughter still works for Vice, but she did work for Vice. Yeah, right. And David respected a lot of what Vice did, and he thought that was in some ways kind of a cheap shot. You know, I mean, Shane was acting like an ass, but that it was a cheap shot in some ways. But that was what, like, if you were a member of David's tribe, you know, he and you called them up and you said there are a bunch of guys out front with pickaxes and flamethrowers. He would say, "All right, I have a pea shooter. You know, I'll be there in 10 minutes." Mm. Yeah, that's just who he was.
Thank you, Seth. Jill Abramson was the executive editor of the New York Times. In my time at the Times, that was the sun god. That was the place. I'd love you to speak about your relationship with, I mean, who edited David Carr and your relationship with him personally, but also the institutional reality that he became. A most unlikely, but now forever iconic New York Times guy.
Well, I had the somewhat unenviable position of often I was the editor of David Carr, because whenever David's column was controversial, it would come to me.
How about his piece on Sam Zell in Chicago?
Right.
On those rare occasions.
Right, on the rare occasions. So, but the thing about David is that he had a sure sense than anybody covering the area he covered about who was doing their job right and who was veering wildly off course. And I can't remember ever looking at one of his columns and feeling alarmed in the sense of, oh no, he's really wrong here. Maybe a couple of times he had a little bit too much fun in sort of calling someone to task, and I would say, like, let's just tone that down like a notch. But that was rare too. I mean, his column ran as he wrote it, I would say 99% of the time over the years. And, you know, the main thing about David's column is it was so much fun to read every week. And it was so much fun to read because he had a blast reporting it. And that oozed from almost every sentence he wrote. Seth used the word, you know, tribal for, you know, the way David felt about the Times. And certainly he was, to a degree, protective about the Times. But I think when he had the confrontation with Shane Smith, the button that Vice pushed is he felt the whole tradition of experienced, deep foreign correspondence was being dismissed and was being taken very casually by Shane Smith, who was assuming because you got some flashy video in an exotic location that somehow substituted for what David saw as the real deal. And he had such a sure sense of what the real deal was in journalism. He just did.
What was it?
And, you know, I think what is interesting about David's column is that as much of a cheerleader as he was for quality journalism and for the New York Times, he was also, like, determined to keep the Times honest in his own way. And at the end of the year, he did an interesting column called, you know, People Who Were Going to Be on the Hot Seat in 2015. And in fact, one of their seats got so hot they're not there anymore already. And that's, you know, Deborah Turness, who was the head news executive at NBC News. So when I say David had a sure sense, he had, you know, a clear sense of where things at NBC were heading. But he put Mark Thompson, the CEO of the New York Times, on that list, which, you know, took some guts to, you know, spotlight your own boss in a way, the head of the company. But, you know, that was David. He was gonna call them as he saw them. And that's why people put so much trust and stock in the column that he wrote. Because he was an honest broker, and he could be, you know, fiercely protective of the values of the New York Times, which he passionately believed in and promoted. But he was honest and clear-eyed about it, too. And he would frequently, you know, just walk into my office with all kinds of ideas. He had his heart set for a while that we would make the whole Times newsroom into essentially a reality live streaming video show. He thought, like, the parade, and in some ways it was kind of an irresistible notion. It would have made it hard to get any real work done in a way.
Well, that was the beauty.
He just never understood why the Times has had a hard time cracking the code of video on the web. And he would always say, like, it's ridiculous. The best show ever is happening right here in our hallways. And, you know, he wanted, you know, live streaming New York Times office.
That was the conviction that lit up that documentary page one. It sort of lights
one
goes on.
One thing, Chris, that you may recall or not recall about page one is that someone who realized immediately that there's only going to be one star of page one, i.e. David Carr, was me. I'm not in the documentary. You see me scowling at a news meeting once, but I just decided, just move out of the way, Abramson. There's another star of this show.
I'd like you to develop this, what was me, a major fascination in how he became almost, not bigger than the Times, but he became the quintessential Times guy.
Yeah,
when he died,
I would be careful with bigger than the Times. He was not bigger than the Times.
No,
I also think David would be the first one, when you said canonization, he would have shot you in the head. He would have. I mean, enough. He was, you know, David was David. He wasn't Walter Lippmann. He wasn't bigger than the Times. He was a really great reporter who covered the hell out of the area he knew best about, and that's who he was. And he was a ton of fun, and he was a great parent. Like, there is no one I knew who was prouder of his girls than David was. And he was, as someone on the audio that we were listening to earlier, he was a tremendous mentor, and he was the biggest booster of young women reporters at the Times of anyone that I work with. He marched into my office. He was furious at me when I assigned Amy Chozek to cover Hillary Clinton first full time, which I did now fully a year ago. And he was furious because she had been in the media group working with him. And, you know, he was mentoring her, and I was getting in the way of what was a beautiful friendship, to quote Casablanca. And he was angry at me. And that is, like, the kind of relationship I had with David. He would just walk in steaming some of the time.
I want to take back the canonization. That's the wrong category. What I was thinking of was that in the day after he died, in the reporting, Arthur Sulzberger, who effectively owns the paper, said that he was one of the great Times people of all time. And a funny little story for me, I never met David, but I had written him the day before he died. We were all still laughing about John Stewart's line about Brian Williams's defenestration. John Stewart had said, "Can you imagine that? Somebody in this country getting fired for lying about Iraq?" And we thought, that's finally our excuse to get David on our program and, mm-hmm. and talk about it. And so I sent him an email on the Tuesday, and on the Wednesday, and on the Thursday, as we finished our program, as it happened with Roger Cohen of the Times, Mary McGrath charged in and said, "You're not going to believe this, but David Carr collapsed in the Times tonight and died." And as it happened, I saw Roger Cohen several days in succession after that, and we were talking about it, and Roger was, you know, he's out of another model of the classic New York Times guy, but he said, "That's amazing," in the obituary. He said, "Can you remember a New York Times reporter who was memorialized with a picture above the fold in the New York Times? Did David Halberstam?" And we were trying to remember, did James Reston get remembered with that play, and, or, you know, Anthony Lewis, whom we still revere, and many other historic New York Times contributors.
Well, they died after long, full lives, and David died in the newsroom way too early. It's a big difference.
Mm-hmm. And still, I comparisons are odious, and I don't mean it that way, but it's simply that David, in his life, as well as in his death, became a new paradigm to how to.
David I knew would be like so comfortable
it's hard to think of him as a paradigm because I don't see anyone else being the next David Carr.
Right.
I mean,
it's not gonna happen again.
Yeah, it's. I think. Sort of building off what Jill said, I think one of the reasons why David is so incredible and was so incredible was because of everything outside of what he did that ended up in the newspaper. I mean, just the way he treated people, the way he interacted with people, the way he mentored people, the way he cheerleaded for people. This is probably going to be a shock to people, but the media is not full of a lot of cheerleaders. It's full of people who, like me, who are petty and jealous, exactly, anxious and looking for an angle. And the first and only time I had a cover story in Newsweek, it was actually about the Times, and I think we put it to bed at like 11:30 on a Saturday night. And then at 11:45, David called me and was like, "Are you done? We got to go celebrate." And it just, like, he wasn't calling as someone at the Times, he was calling as a friend, and mm-hmm. he was the person who knew that was when I was closing this piece. I mean, that's just what he was like. And one other comment.
If I can just interrupt for a second, because I took my phone out, not to be rude, but to try and capture David a little bit, what, like, when we speak about him in stentorian terms, what has me thinking he'd be laughing at us a little bit is he also wrote a column. I used to email with him all the time long after I was fired by the Times, and he wrote also at the end of the year a very good column about the Charlie Hebdo cartoons, and You know, he was writing about the need to protect the most offensive kind of speech, that was particularly important. That was the theme of his column. And so I wrote him a kind of devilish email, because I wrote him kind of reading between the lines, because the Times had decided not to publish the cartoons. Like, again, I sort of thought, this is David sort of trying to keep the paper honest. So I sent him an email, and he wrote back to me, "Ha! You never miss a beat, do you, boss? I f-ing miss you and your big brass ovaries." I mean, that was David, you know. It just was.
Did he clear a path for others like him at the time, do you think?
Well, I mean, David is like, there are not many others like him.
No, assume that. But I mean,
you know, the one thing I will say about that is I think because of how, they're not going to be any more Davids, but because of how he came in, and because and I think I just will have to be guarded against in the coming days, there's a way of romanticizing the whole thing of, you know, the drug thing, the alcohol thing, and then, you know, you turn it all around. But he was, like, ashamed of all of that. You know, he was not particularly, you know, he knew when he wrote the book that it was a story, but he was not, like, something that, you know, he thought should be out there as, like, romanticized or glorified. But the interesting thing was, I think because he had so many travails, the whole piece you were mentioning about him mentoring young women, and I've never seen, like, a writer, a journalist die, and so many African-American writers talk about how he mentored them. Mm. He had, like, this deep sense of the work, you know, and he knew that, you know, there were all these kinds of barriers that kept people from different positions in journalism, and he hated that. You know, he, for all of his roughness and gruffness, you know, and I have to tell you, like, from the first time I met him, all of his whiteness, because that was how I perceived him. He was deeply concerned about diversity. And even if I say it as diversity, that, like, it conjures a picture in your mind that does not quite, you know, get at it. I guess he was deeply concerned about fairness. Yeah. You know, he was deeply concerned about fairness and justice and who got, you know, what job. And, you know, when he ran his own shop, he ran it that way. You know, after he was done with his own shop, he was very, very conscious about who he talked to, who he mentored, who he took up for. So while, you know, it's true there won't be another David, I think he was conscious that his path was not normal, and that other people's whose paths are not normal. You know, and I, you know, if anything, I feel like I have in this that, like, that those people should have shots too. You know, he was just huge on that. He really, really believed that.
You know, in terms of where he kind of imagined his own work. He used to describe his writing a lot as like spitballs off a battleship, like when he was, you know, writing about a CEO you know, he knew obviously on one level that wasn't true, but he also would always, whenever I would congratulate him on something or we would talk about something, he would sort of, I guess, remind me and himself that people weren't returning David Carr's calls, they were returning David Carr from the New York Times' call. Mm-hmm. You know, he didn't have an exaggerated sense of his own importance, and he certainly could have had an exaggerated sense of his own importance because there were a lot of people telling him, you know, how crucial and vital he was. But I think, you know, the phrase spitballs off a battleship always sort of encapsulated something else for me about David, which is, and I think it relates to what you're saying, you know, he didn't have any illusions that he was going to change the world, that he was going to make, you know, journalism a more equitable or fair or diverse place writ large. And, you know, he sort of knew that whatever he did was just going to be these small little things, and he felt like that was what a human being's role is in the universe, to try and do whatever small things you can to sort of push things on a path of, you know, righteousness and goodness.
The one thing he wrote that I do think actually brought about some degree of healthy institutional change is he did one of the best investigative stories ever on the Tribune Company.
Yeah.
And what really fired David up about that story was this outrageous culture of sexual harassment that was at the root of also their terrible mismanagement. I mean, it was like really a sick corporate culture. And David, you know, got a lot of women who had worked at the Tribune Company to speak very honestly to him, and he was the first reporter any of them had confided in. I mean, no one knew the degree to which these bozos at the top of the Tribune Company were, you know, just behaving in this most outrageous manner. It really, like, infuriated David. There's a scene, in fact, in the movie The Front Page, where he's doing one of his final interviews on the phone with one of the executives there, and he's practically vibrating with rage as he's talking. But that was, you know, a magnificent, meticulous piece of investigative reporting work that sadly, because of the rhythm of his weekly column and, you know, doing, he invented the carpetbagger, you know, the kind of fun video coverage of the award season. Yeah, he invented that. I mean, he had so many balls in the air that, you know, it's difficult for him to do sustained long, months-long projects. But that one got to him, and he was like a dog with a bone. He just kept going until he had the goods. And that, you know, is, for me, if I was going to tell all of you to read one thing by David Carr, that's the one for me, anyway.
Yeah, no, it's a great piece. One of the interesting things is he did, like that basic issue of fans, as you said, you know, it really got him riled up. And I, at the end of his time at City Paper, he did a piece on a journalist who I don't think is a journalist anymore, a woman by the name of Ruth Shalit.
Sure.
Yeah, and she was writing for the New Republic at this time. She had written this big, you know, it was probably supposed to be an expose like that on the Washington Post and about affirmative action and how affirmative action, I'm sure you remember this piece, right? Because maybe you
it
do too.
It was basically calling them out for being hypocrites.
Right. And he went after her because it turned out like that she had plagiarized and all these things. And I think it got him that, you know, Washington Post is trying to do something, maybe, you know, clumsily or however you want to see it, you know, in terms of, you know, making sure that they're inclusive voices. You're calling them out, and at the same time, you're plagiarizing people, you know what I mean? And you're getting, like, basic facts wrong. And he would get, you know, and I think maybe this is part of it. I don't know how you guys feel about this. I don't know that every journalist has this or needs it. But he had, you know, a sort of righteous bone in him that would get him going, you know what I mean? You would see that even in the column, I would say, from time to time.
Oh, yeah,
you know,
absolutely.
You would.
Yeah.
You know, we're running down our time, but I'm not sure we've heard enough from about his Boston University career and maybe from the journalism department here. Are there people who would like to make a point, ask a question, shed a little light on David at BU?
Could I maybe set it up because I am the person who enabled his coming here?
Sure, please.
Because it's, you know, vivid memory to me when David came to propose that he would have still another ball in the air and be, you know, teaching as like a real faculty member at BU. But, you know, what I remember is like how excited he was about the prospect of teaching here. And especially after I said yes, he could do it. When he started putting the curriculum, just picking the reading for his course, he looked like someone who had been sitting at like the best buffet table in the world, you know, because he could pick the sirloin and the lobster, and in fact, he did pick the lobster as one of the pieces. But he just was like so enthralled, and he was very scared that he wasn't going to be great at it. You know, he was scared that the students wouldn't find him that interesting.
Just kind of and, hysterical. I mean,
you know,
was this a book project? Was it a sort of a an alternative career?
No, it just he got it in his head that at this phase of his life, he knew a lot about the craft of journalism and the prospect. You know, I think his kids were kind of college age, that just he sort of loved people that age. He could see that he could be a formative influence and on very bright, motivated students who wanted to write and explore other aspects of journalism, and he just was on fire about it. He really wanted to do it.
You know, Jill mentioned what a great dad he was, and then when David in those audio clips was talking about the grand caper, I think teaching was another grand caper, and one of the reasons it was a grand caper was because it was going to allow him to come and see his daughter, who's a freshman at BU. He didn't obviously know that when he first started here, but he and I talked about it, and that was one of the angles that he was working. The last time I saw David in person was when he dropped his daughter off at BU in the fall. And he didn't seem well to me, and I asked him afterwards. He came over and he met my kids, and afterwards we were taking a walk, and I asked him if everything was okay, and he said that he felt like the one thing he knew how to do was to be a dad, now his girls were gone, and that was going to be tough, and. That kind of floored me. I mean, you know, like the one thing you know how to do, are you kidding me?
Seth, you know, just really quickly, I think you actually are onto something, though. I make a great point about David. The thing is, David became a father at a point where, like, there wasn't much else good going on in his life.
True.
And he got, and like, so, and I think this actually ties back to, like, what you were saying about his lack of ego. His self-esteem was there. Like it's like, you know what I mean? Like when you have nothing else, you can come home and you can take care of these little girls.
Right.
And if that works out, you become somebody, you know? And then this other stuff happens later, you know what I mean? And then when that goes away, you know, you can totally see how it's doing.
I think it is interesting that when the Times Magazine ran the excerpt of David's book, and we all remember the book at the Night of the Gun, the title of the magazine piece was actually Me and My Girl.
Which is how, you know, I mean, and his Twitter avatar was his girls. I mean, you know, it was you know, he really was a great father. And actually you know, he met my son for all of 5 minutes, and when I was going out to New York to the funeral, to David's funeral, and I told my son Max that I wasn't going to be here and I had to go to a funeral, I said, well, you actually met David, you probably don't remember, but you met him, and I showed him a picture, and he said, no, I don't know if I remember, and then he said, no, yeah, I do remember, and I assumed, like, all right, well, that's a 5-year-old, you know, deciding that something did happen. That, and he said, he played the buzzing bee with me, which is exactly what happened. I mean, David, and as soon as I told Jill that, I didn't even need to say he played, Jill, his wife, just said, oh, the buzzing bee, because that's what he would do with kids. And David was physically not a teddy bear, I would say. You know, he was a big, kind of odd-looking guy, like a, this impossibly small neck because of some of his cancer treatments, and then kind of went out, and he shaved kind of irregularly, and it was so great seeing my son with him, because my son, like, saw him and immediately was like, oh, okay, that's someone who's on my wavelength. Like, we can, you know, we can run together. And so he, my son went up to him and sprayed him with a spray bottle of stagnant water that had been sitting there for like 8 months and smelled so awful. And David looked at him and said, that's nasty, dude, what are you doing? And my son sort of for a second was like, oh shit, I fucked up. And then David immediately went into the buzzing bee, and he was like, all right, this is cool, I can hang with this guy. But and I think in some ways, I mean, I don't know what you guys feel, but I think in some ways that's one of the reasons why, you know, he was above the fold in the Times. One of the reasons why his wake had so many people, you know, going on and on, because he everyone who he interacted with personally, he had that kind of effect on. I mean, he met a friend of mine at my wedding, a concert promoter, who like 8 years later got him tickets to a show. And my friend said that David wrote him the nicest letter that he has ever received in his entire life as thanks. You know, talking about how much it meant to him and what it meant for him and his wife to be able to see this show. And, you know, my friend said, I'll remember that forever. I mean, I immediately was thinking, like, yeah, I've never sent him a letter thanking him for anything.
Chris, I actually met some of his students because it's a little eerie. I have an eerie feeling being on this stage tonight because the only other time I've ever been here was a few months ago. I, you know, did an interview for WBUR show too on a different Monday night, obviously, but with, you know, just a conversation with David, and that time flew by, but, you know, a number of his students came to hear it, and, you know, it was obvious that, you know, even in just a few months' time, that he had established himself as, you know, very cool, popular professor here at BU, who, you know, had a following among the student body. And, you know, I could tell that, you know, there were a number of people in the BU administration who were so excited that he was here, that he was a meaningful addition to the faculty.
When he met with your students when you were teaching at MIT, what was their reaction?
That was the best day in the world. It was immediately clear. It was the best class that I, you know, I was a teacher. It was the best class they'd ever had.
What happened?
I taught. It was essay. I taught advanced essay workshop, and he came. Boy, they got it that day. And I think that semester I only had like 5 kids. So he came, Brett Anderson, who's just a dynamic food writer, who's another one of these guys that David just sort of pulled up, you know, out of nowhere, another, not so, you know, prolific as me, but, you know, somewhat of a fuck up himself. Brett is there, and Brett is, you know, he was doing the, what's the fellowship over at Harvard?
Nieman.
He was doing the Nieman over at Harvard, and so Brett just hung out, and so they got critique from David Carr, and Brett Anderson, it was only like 5 of them there. So, and I had the essay sent in advance, and I think Brett had told me he was coming, so I sent them there. David, so I said, okay, we're gonna have, you know, workshop, and usually, you know, everybody looks at everybody's essay, gives critique and everything. David had prepared remarks.
Yeah.
Did he do that in your class?
Yeah.
I mean, wait, what? You prepared remarks?
It was always dangerous to invite him because he would always make you look bad.
Yeah, no, it was humiliating. And not only that, so he prepared remarks. It was the best class they had, and I was so sad that more kids weren't there for that. But I saw Seth, I think this must have been at the funeral or maybe the wake, but I was saying to you, I just, because I agreed to come up here and teach, because I was looking at a syllabus. I said, dude, does your syllabus look like that? Because, you know, clearly I've been slumming. And I asked a bunch of other professors, and they were all like, no, my syllabus looks like I pulled it together just the night before class. mine does not, fortunately, because I'm teaching here at BU, his class. But he was, and see, the thing that I'll tell you about that, David was that guy before he came here. David was that guy before I brought him into MIT. I always felt that my time at City Papers was what J School should have been. He would see something that he liked in Esquire, in GQ, in Vanity Fair, in the New Yorker. He would Xerox it, maybe pull 2 or 3 articles like that together, and then make the whole staff read it. And you would spend a day, you know, like he would take maybe a couple hours out of the day, and you would have to talk about those articles. He would bring editors down, you know, from magazines. And oh my God, I remember this. Jesus. And I'm young, like I have no idea what's happening, like, and how much that means at that time. I must have been like 21 years old. And he brought somebody down from Vanity Fair, and you had to submit your articles like beforehand in order to let the guy read it and give critique. Now, I don't understand what it means that you have an editor from Vanity Fair that's gonna give you critique. Well, yeah, but David has hooked this up. I waited too long and sent it in. And I said, am I too late? Yes, you're too late. You won't get critique. And I'm like, oh, Then he writes me like an hour later. He says, he's graciously said that he'll read your stuff. Totally being David. But he, you know, when you went to work for him, and I was so sad because I always used to ask him, are you going to run a shop again? Because he didn't just edit. I mean, he actually taught you how to, which is something that I never saw. That never happened again. Anywhere where I was at. In fact, you know, I've been having this discussion, or I've been thinking about initiating this discussion at The Atlantic about how, you know, maybe I can help out with that and we can be better with that. He taught. I mean, he taught. And, you know, to be 20 and get that for a good 3 or 4 years was remarkable. And that was why I tell the kids all the time, like, I know you're being taught, but not, this. It's just not going to happen again. Mm. Not like that.
Mm. Thank you. I don't know. Did Chris Daly? Did you want to?
Chris, you were asking about his time at BU, which was the last.
Stand up and shout. And maybe take my mic, Chris.
Christopher Daly from Medford, Massachusetts.
Thanks, Chris. I just think it's, you know, it's apropos to say a few words on behalf of the faculty and the whole community here at BU, because it was David's last institutional commitment. And we were very lucky to be given a pile of dough from a generous alum, Andrew Lack, who's now back into the fire. And Dean Tom Fiedler asked me to chair a committee of professors to go find a person who could explain the business behind quality journalism. That was the challenge that Andy Lack gave to us. So in those discussions, it soon came obvious to us that the person we really wanted was the one that David Carr would call when he needed insight or, you know, a scoop or an explanation. And it was not too long after that that Andy Lack said, well, you know, I saw David Carr, and I mentioned it to him, and he didn't say no. And so we allowed ourselves to get very excited, and we pursued David and had a lot of conversations with him. And at one point I did ask him, why do you want to do this? What is it about this that's appealing? And I think his answer was very interesting. He said, well, you know, I'm asked all the time to be a guest speaker in other people's courses. And he had a hard time saying no, you know, as we all know him as a very generous person. And he said he felt like he was being scraped across the toast, too thin, and that he didn't know what he could do with a course of his own. If instead of just coming in for the 45 minutes or hour show, whether he could actually put something together himself. And of course, you know, he could, he did, and I just regret that this night falls during our spring break, because otherwise the house would be full, not just of the faculty, but especially of students. Students loved him, and they queued up to take his courses. There was a waiting list. We are still registering what this loss means to us. It's been a great shock to all of us. Glad to see everyone here tonight.
How to say, one of the things I miss acutely about David Carr, looking forward, is that he covered this story of this transition, or evolution, or revolution, or competition, or whatever it was, with just an unbelievable enthusiasm for all the players. I mean, he was a critic, but he also loved the young writers, and he loved the majesty of the Gray Lady of used to be West 43rd Street. He loved it with a passion, and he brought to it a sense that you know, the game is never over. It's always developing. It's always going to be new. It's always going to be fun for young people to put not put the paper in the typewriter, but to try out their voices, learn, etc. And it's never going to stop. Short of it is, I mean, who do we trust after David to keep honest and enthusiastic score on what is not just an industrial rivalry? It's the way our brains work and deal with, I mean, unbelievably serious public dilemmas and that we're all talking about. I mean, I was. when I think about journalism, I always like to force myself to come back to the public conversation, not the players, not the technology, not the businesses, but the state of our thinking. Where do we look for guidance on that sort of thing?
Well, he would, I'm pretty sure, I could be wrong, you guys can correct, but I think he would tell you to look to yourself. And I say that because he was so big on like social media. You know, it's like the funny thing about that moment, like, and it's a great, you know, scene where, you know, he goes after, you know, Vice. He was not going after them in some sort of nostalgic way. You know, he you know, believed in the future, as, you know, the student said here, and as, you know, you got, you know, from his clips. He really, really did believe it. He would tweet things out. Like, he would ask questions, I think less so in the past year or so, but he would ask questions on Twitter. You know, he was not a, I think Jill hit on to something very early on, and I'm sorry, I don't mean to rake you over the coals about this, but I think he would not, he would not want people to ask, who do we trust after David Carr? I think the best thing is he would say, trust yourself, mm-hmm. You know. We all hold him in that place, and I understand where that question comes from. I understand, you know, where you know, all of the praise, you know, God knows I've heaped my share on him tonight. But he saw himself as doing a job. You know, I mean, he thought he was good at it, but, you know, he saw himself as doing the essential work. And he did not believe it was beyond anyone to go out and do that work themselves. You know, one of the interesting things is, like, at least when I worked with him, he didn't talk too much about, you know, I mean, he would talk a little bit about writing talent. But after that, I mean, the essential, you know, reporting work, which he was big on in his column. You know, he never wanted to, you know, have a column where he was just sort of, you know, going off the top. Exactly. Yeah. No, he hated that. He hated that. He believed that was just a matter of, you know, just shoe leather and picking up the phone. He really, really believed that. You know, he believed in a kind of democracy.
It was like that was the number one of the Ten Commandments.
Right.
And the flip side was, I mean, I was talking with him about a reporter at the Times, who I knew and who had moved into a new beat, and I had told David, you might want to look out for him. And there was silence on the other end of the line. Whoa. And I was like, David, and he said, he doesn't report. And that was the end. He said, he doesn't report. And that was the end
was
of the conversation.
He
did, but it just, like, David was not going to be helping him at all. He didn't put in enough work. And the flip side of that was, you know, when for the first bunch of years that I knew him, we were essentially covering the same beat. We were both writing about the media. I sort of didn't realize until later how crazy this is. But I would call him all the time and be like, hey, I'm working on this story that you just wrote about. Do you know anyone who would be good for me to talk to? And he'd be like, oh yeah, sure, hang on. And he would give me, you know, 10 names and numbers and then introductions. And it's like, if you did the reporting, he was gonna stand up for you and believed you could do it. But I think that you're right, that, you know, it's not, he didn't have any illusions about there being some secret sauce to what he was doing. I think, you know, the voice was one thing that no one will replicate. But, you know, I think he felt like if you picked up the phone and if you made the calls and you kept calling back, and that you were going to be able to ultimately get the story. I mean, that's what he taught you.
And I think, like, if you're going to, like, run a news, like, you have to kind of believe that, right? Like,
yeah.
I mean, you can't just say to young people, hey, there's a talent for reporting.
Well, but I'm always surprised at the number of journalists that I know that seem allergic to reporting. Maybe you're not at the Times, but...
I would say that the most frequent criticism that I would have of pieces that came to my desk was, It needs more reporting. Yeah. But, you know, there, in terms of who comes next after David, I think, you know, because he was writing a weekly column, I think in some ways that was like his perfect form. And he had a great ability to pick things on a particular week at the perfect time. He didn't get on them too early,
right,
before anyone was interested, and he didn't get on them too late after everybody was sick to death of them. Like, if you look at when, for instance, he wrote about cereal, he just hit it. He hit it just as like kind of, I was beginning to hear about from a lot of people, but not so that like we had to do spoiler alerts.
Right, right.
You know, and he had just a very good sense of when and a really broad palette of what he would write about. He would write about tiny little like weekly newspapers still, if they were doing something kind of novel and different from anyone else. Like he had a good rhythm of picking things that weren't being paid attention to at all by anyone else, and then things that were about to be the big thing that we were all talking about.
And I mean, if you look at, you know, just the breadth of what he did, not only at the Times, but before, his career could have gone in any number of ways. I mean, before he went to the Times from the Atlantic in New York, where he was doing long form work. When he was at the Times, he did, he wrote for the magazine, he did arts features, he did a whole bunch of stuff, and any of those I think he probably could have done. I mean, he could have been just a magazine writer, but he kind of found his level. I mean, he ended up where he was supposed to be, and he did all that other stuff, all that, you know, he would continue to interview Neil Young because he thought that was cool, and he thought it was just insane that he had a job where he was allowed to do that. But he would never do that and at the expense of, or he would never do Carpetbagger at the expense of his column. He would never do.
Although even for Carpetbagger, the thing about how dogged and hardworking a reporter he was, I can remember, I would try to seldom take advantage because it made me feel kind of ethically compromised. But, you know, in New York, there's like a movie screening almost every night, like in the lead up to the awards. And it's, you know, a nice multi-course thing, always at some fancy restaurant. And if I would run into David Carr at one of those, he would not be, you know, eating the, you know, wonderful roast beef, whatever dinner. He'd have his notebook out, and, you know, at these like obvious just press events, he'd be like, okay, this is my opportunity to like get to someone interesting who's working on this movie, and I'm gonna get something for Bagger. You know, I'm just gonna get something for it. He was never just like me, you know, accepting the free lunch and going to see the movie.
You're such a slacker. I know.
You're reminding me, reminding us all of all the qualities that were deeper than just plain relentlessness on the phone or getting the facts or reporting. He had judgment. He had imagination. He had humor. He had a heart. He had, in the long run, a kind of judgment that I think we're gonna miss more than anything.
And he was very creative. I mean, I, to be honest with you, was both skeptical and somewhat horrified to contemplate doing the Carpetbagger. I mean, the idea that the Times was gonna take the Golden Globes seriously, like fundamentally, you know, I'm an investigative reporter. That didn't feel good to me. But David, you know, he just like was able to like convince me that he would kind of have a wry sensibility about the spectacle of it all, and that he made a great case for why the awards were like an industry in and of themselves and deserved to be covered as such. Yeah. And so I was like, okay, and you know, he became this sort of whole other persona known as the Carpetbagger. You know, where he would go into Times Square and he'd like roll out a red carpet. It wasn't, you know, some of those early videos are hilarious. He got like very into creating this kind of persona.
Last word. Or Seth, as you like, both of you.
I'll have next to last, and you'll have something about that. We'll do that. I'm sure you have something very profound to say.
No, I definitely.
David, you know, my the only person I had that was even, you know, really close, my grandmother died some years ago, but because you don't, you know, it's your grandmother and there's that, like, a huge age difference and it's somebody, you know, who you love and you care about, but they actually aren't as close to you as somebody like David was to me. David is probably first real, really, really close person I had, you know, who died. And it's tough to, like, say anything because I don't, like, know, you know, how I feel or how I'm supposed to feel. Sorry, Seth, about this. Like Seth was saying how I've not accepted that he's dead, you know? And, like, it seems impossible that he could be dead. You know, I just, like, I have so many memories, you know, and I don't know what that is. I don't know, like there probably should be some sort of neurological, you know, explanation for what I'm going through. I say that to say, you know, I don't have anything, like, huge to say in terms of, like, who David was in the field, you know, of journalism. He was my friend, and I adored him, like, terribly. And he's gone. He's just gone. I mean, and I, you know, that is I'm not good at making people feel good about that because I don't know how to make myself feel good about that. It, you know, I will. It's an enormous, as far as I'm concerned. And you know, I know people die every day, but I can only speak from my, you know, perspective sitting here. It is a huge, huge, huge loss. And you know, just an enormous tragedy.
I was thinking about how at David's wake, Jill brought a box of his reporter's notebooks.
Yes.
And, and when I got there, she said, "Oh, wait right here." And she ran out back and grabbed one and came back with this like grin and said, "Here, this is for you." Mm-hmm. Just looking like it don't like, I felt like it almost smelled like David, like
bag at the hotel.
They were like surgically attached to his hand or something. I guess one thing I want to say is I have been trying to figure out why David was so important to me and why he seems to have also been able to touch so many people. And I think it's because, I think you see this in his book, you see this in his columns, you see this in his work. He was just honest with the world. There wasn't any artifice. So when, you know, the outpouring of emotion that you saw, you know, from people who didn't know him, from people who had never read a single column he wrote and only knew him on Twitter, from people who only knew him from videos online, I think it's because he just, like, he was incapable of being anything other than David. That sounds kind of obvious, but I'm someone other than myself all the time. You know, he lived honestly.
I'm sorry, I have to promise Seth the last word.
I don't want
to. Seth doesn't mind. I want to add one thing, because I wanted, when I saw that video, again, to go back to this clip about Vice, first time I saw it, I said, well, I mean, that's just David. You know, he's clearly not, he's not hamming it up for the camera at all. That's what he did. The thing, you know, about his loss, like when I was thinking about this sadness, is David was, you know, you were talking about like him, you guys were talking about him being like tribal, and that was how he was. Like, people would do something to you, you would forgive them. He would never, he'd be hacking at him to the end of the earth. And you'd be like, listen, it's okay. And I think about this, there was a guy, I'm sorry, I just have to tell this story because like what he did was he would protect me. Like, he would protect me. I was a young man working at an alternative paper in New York, because there's so many and you won't be able to figure out which one it was. And they had ordered me to do a certain job, and I didn't really want it, but they ordered me and they said, listen, you do this job and you know you'll have to do it, but your job will be safe. They were going through, you know, all sorts of problems with money. And I went to have lunch with David, and he said, that's your job? I said, yes. He said, they are shopping your job. I said, no, they're not. They just told me that was mine. He said, no, they're shopping your job. He said, when you go back, you go into your editor's office and you confront them directly immediately. And I did it, and the dude just turned white. I mean, just like he couldn't believe it. I ended up leaving that job. And at the end, you know, it went really, really bad at the end. And, you know, they pulled me in the office at the end, the editor-in-chief, every other top editor at that field, and just went off on how I wasn't, you know, a good reporter, and I didn't have the fire, and I didn't have this, and I didn't have that. You know, and I told Dave this story, and he just sort of absorbed it. Editor-in-chief made the mistake of coming up to the New York Times and seeing David at a social event. And David didn't go off on the guy immediately, but the guy made the deep further mistake of raising my name. He said, well, that guy just didn't have a fight. And David just tore his head off. I mean, just tore his head off. And this happened, right? And I was so young that, like, when I heard this story, I almost didn't want him to do it because I was still in the face. But maybe they were right, David. Like maybe they were right. But he was like, no, they're totally wrong. And don't you ever say that to me again. Like, he knew, he could look at you and he could see, like more than, at least I'll just speak for myself. He saw way, way more than what I saw myself. And so when he died, it was like, I mean, I felt and I feel this tremendous sense of loneliness. You know, I don't have like a way to make this like pretty. You know, I mean, this is like the raw me, you know? I don't know how one gets that back. I don't know what happens. I don't know if one just walks around with that gaping wound forever or what that is. You know, or you find your way out. I just don't know.
He was a mentor. Pay it forward.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's what it is.
Yeah, no, I would agree with that. I would agree with that.
Stand up and say it again, once more.
He was a mentor. What I'm hearing from these guys is he mentored them all the time, and he was mentoring everybody. When you have no young people who are trying to figure out how to go, have them hook up with somebody who can be a mentor for them. Listen to the mentors, learn from them. That's what it's about. And when you get better, mentor the people behind you. That's how you learn.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you all. Thank you, Ta-Nehisi Coates, Seth Mnookin, Jill Abramson, and thank you all too. Thank you, David. Thank you.